My first interest in life was magic tricks. I was, you know, just interested in the mystery and the magicalness of everything, and I suppose that was to translate eventually into my interest in hypnosis. One day, I was walking down one of the main streets of Brighton, England, and I went in to see a vaudeville and see a hypnotist at work. And he made people dance with brooms and did silly things, and I thought to myself, this is not just parlor entertainment. There's got to be something behind this. Maybe if people could be made to do silly things, maybe they could be made to do sensible things. That's what I thought when I was 15 years old. And so I looked into it. There wasn't many books on the subject in those days, and it was looked upon as charlatanism. We're talking about, you know, I'm 68 years old now. So. But finally I got the hang of it, and I learned to hypnotize people. Some officers came one night, and they heard that I could do this sort of thing, and it was very entertaining in my barracks. I had everyone cleaning my boots and my and cleaning my rifle for me, and they did more for me than the sergeants, you know. I think the sergeant got a little jealous. And the officers came one night and said, can you do this? I said, yes, I can. So I hypnotized both the officers, and nobody did any fire duty that night because they were asleep too. But the point is, there's more to that than meets the eye. And I found out that the world, the life itself is hypnosis. I actually went to America, and there was a book written called Bridie Murphy. It was all about a person who was reincarnated, and they found their bones in an Irish cemetery, and there was a story that coincided with the person who was supposed to have been reincarnated, connected to the bones in the graveyard, the story of their life. So it was a big rage, and it was supposed to be a regression under hypnosis. There's no such thing, of course, but that's another story. But there is no such thing as a regression. Under hypnosis, a person can fabricate almost anything. The UFO sightings, a lot of it are people stricken by some kind of hysterical, hypnotic hysteria that is very prevalent in this day and age. What I discovered was, though, to cut a long story short, after founding the Institute of Hypnosis in Houston, Texas, and I was there for 7 years working with all kinds of people with great success, I discovered something frightening. That everybody in the world, with no exception, including yourself as the interviewer, everyone, there are no exceptions, right up to the President of the United States. It doesn't make any difference. But I don't care if you're driving Cadillacs or if you're just working in a store, an ordinary fellow. Everyone is under some kind of hypnotic spell. And they do move and have their being not from within themselves, like human beings are supposed to, but they're controlled by their culture. By conditioned reflex response signals, post-hypnotic suggestion, if you like. So if you're born in Borneo, you'd be a cannibal. If an American was born in Borneo, he'd make a good cannibal. And the cannibals don't have any tolerance for real human beings. They are threatened by real human beings, and mama cannibal is proud only of a better cannibal, if she can produce one, you see. And so in America, same way, every race and every color and every creed and everything you do from the day you're born comes from the influences of your environment, and the environment keeps you captive. It's almost like post-traumatic stress syndrome. We all live through conditioned reflex signals. You get up in the morning, you have coffee, and everything, the smells and the sights and the sounds sort of move you, and you move through the day like a drone. In such a useless way, in a 9-to-5 syndrome, and life is meaningless, and life is death. But that kind of life leads to death, and we have a lot of people rebelling against it as if they could, as if they knew how, but they don't. So we spend a whole life conforming to the pressures of life and what life expects of us. As several psychiatrists and psychologists, well, not several, hundreds, I have on my file who use these techniques today with astounding results. Like, instead of taking 10 years to make a person well, it takes a person with a multiple personality disorder can become well in a month. And people with other disorders, like a few days. So I have several psychiatrists, Dr. George Hayter is one of them, who has been doing my techniques for the last 15 years with astounding results. So, but I ran afoul of the law. at one time. I didn't know it, you see, and so they got me for practicing medicine without a license, but I wasn't practicing medicine. I was practicing, you know, helping people. Actually, I was teaching them some very spiritual principles, like you should live from yourself, you know. So they sent a man in one day, and who had actually been a patient of a mental hospital, but he was with a business bureau, and so he said, you know, that he was an alcoholic. And I told him, I said, well, the reason why you're an alcoholic is because you're imitating your father that you hate. And so if you hate your father, who is an alcoholic, you have two grounds for becoming an alcoholic. One, you become what you hate, so you have the conflict your father had. Two, you have the same need for alcohol as your father had. So that was called diagnosis. So I wasn't very versed in the law in those days. I was only 32 years old with four kids, and so I didn't know how to handle that very well. So they sent me to jail for 19 days. Actually, it was a 30-day sentence, but they couldn't wait to get rid of me because I was hypnotizing everybody in the jail. And the headlines read, hypnotist practices spells in cells. And there were actually people bribing the guards in the jail to they wanted me to treat their sons. And there were actually people in jail. You can look it in the Houston Post and the Houston Chronicle. There was an inmate saying, I'm glad I went to jail. Child molesters and people like that, I was helping. So they put me in solitary confinement, because when I was in solitary confinement, the inmates of the jail, because I had money, but I didn't want to flaunt it in front of them to get special privileges, they bought me chicken, and they took care of me in solitary confinement. They appreciated my help so much. And they don't have such services in jail to help people, to teach them how to control themselves. Because when they get out, they go back in the same old circumstances, the same old pressures, and they don't know how to deal with it, and they become influenced again to do bad things, you see. So I bought a house trailer, cut a long story short, and I headed west to Los Angeles, and someone put me in touch with a radio station, Mr. Al Williams, who's been my very good friend for the last 36 years. I'm still on one of his stations right now. He's a wonderful man, and he wouldn't let me go on. He thought I was too naive for radio. It was religious radio, 15 minutes, but wasn't very expensive. So he wouldn't let me go on. He didn't want to see me hurt. He was just a good man. But when I went on, I was an instant success. And then he gave me time on radio to do a talk show. He said, can you do a talk show? I said, I don't know, I'll try. And so that's how I began my talk radio program, and I have a talk radio network right now. I went through a period of time where America was sliding.